Hello, Design Manchester. My name's Alex McDowell, and I'm so sorry not to be with you today in person, but this is a transmission from across the oceans. I'm sitting in my lab in Los Angeles at USC. So I'm a production designer for 30 years. I've worked in film, music videos, commercials, but my background was in painting. So I was a painting student in 1975 at Central School of Art, fairly sure that I was just going to have a career in fine art, and I was responsible for booking the gigs along with Sebastian Conran. And a young man walked in off the street and said, "Do you want a band to play for free tomorrow night, mate?" And we said, "Sure." And the next night, the Sex Pistols played their first gig. And my life kind of changed at that moment. So then I started working with bands. I started working with the Pistols, with Vivian Westwood, printing t-shirts. Moved into a squat in Stoke Newington, where a lot of those bands were living. The squat was an amazing place. It was, I think, maybe 10 houses in a row, all of the backyards cut, all knocked down. So it was a single yard in the back, and then holes from house to house up in the attic and then the top floors, so that if there was a raid in one house, then everyone could move to another house. It was a sort of an entire community of completely ramshackle, run-down, abandoned council houses in Stoke Newington. I started printing t-shirts, I started making record sleeves. Glenn Matlock, the man who had come in off the street to ask about the Pistols playing, asked me to design the Rich Kids album, started creating a series of albums and record sleeves. And then Iggy Pop, who I was doing the Soldier album for, asked if we knew anyone who could make music videos. And we said, sure. We didn't really know what a music video was, but we set up to do so and shot his first three music videos. And that became kind of the next iteration of my series of falling off cliffs of a career. I started working with Tim Pope, doing a lot of videos for The Cure. And then eventually America beckoned. I went to Los Angeles, where I am now. And so in 86, I moved here and started working increasingly on music videos, much less on graphics. Eventually, I started working at a company called Propaganda, which was really the busiest studio in town for music videos, and connected with David Fincher. And for a solid year, 7 days a week, I designed everything that David shot, everything that David directed, music videos, commercials. And that led almost directly into film. Brett Leonard, who had brought a script in that was really specifically focused on virtual reality, called Lawnmower Man. And then after Lawnmower Man, I went back to do commercials, and then I hooked up with Alex Proyas, who was a propaganda director, designed The Crow. And The Crow started to kind of turn back into this punk space that I'd started in 1975, 1976. Was very much a reference. Those early days of London, the kind of gigs that we were portraying in The Crow, the black and white kind of desolate Detroit that the original comic book portrayed, all kind of folded into the way that the look of that film was. And I think it was an important film because it shifted the audience dramatically from a more traditional cinematic audience to really a music audience. You know, the music video audience came on to The Crow, and it became a very successful film. And then the next film I did was to hook up again with David Fincher to design a film called Fight Club. You know, it was a moment in time that reflected the spirit of the turn of the century. Everything about the book and the film, I think, takes you to that cusp of the two centuries. And so I wanted to talk about one example in the film, one sort of central piece of design for me, and how that evolved, and a little bit about the design process that we go through. The Paper Street House, which is, you know, the house where the Space Monkeys live and Tyler Durden's home base, was a complete fiction. It came about, first of all, from my early scouting of Detroit. In Detroit, every year there was something called Devil's Night. And Devil's Night, houses were burnt methodically year after year until there were entire streets in Detroit where there were just single houses standing on a whole city block. And we took that in as an initial inspiration. So although Fight Club was shot in Los Angeles, it was some kind of a hybrid city that was, in my mind, somewhere between Detroit and maybe the outskirts of LA, like San Pedro or Long Beach. What had been happening at the time was the Port of Los Angeles had decided that they needed more room for containers. So they bought up 10 city blocks north of the ocean and destroyed all the houses in preparation for moving a new container port into that area. And so we moved in and built a house right there, which became the Paper Street House, sitting on its own on a city block, very much inspired by that kind of Detroit desolation. It was a house that, you know, initially we started building it and people came by and said, you know, they're about to destroy this area, you really shouldn't build a new house. And then 2 months later, people would come by again and they'd say, we had no idea this house had been here. We thought everything had been knocked down. We were building, you know, as one does in film, you're kind of this accelerated process of history. The house itself was something that we had to script ourselves. The script and the book, in fact, just give a general description. But it seemed important to me for a couple of reasons that we build a history for the house from the ground up. So we actually invented an entire backstory. We imagined that this house had been built by a captain of industry 100 years ago. It's a 100-year-old house. In 1900, he'd put this house at the outskirts of a new city that was springing up in the countryside, beautiful old Victorian house, and his family moved in. And then through the generations, by the time of his sort of grandchildren or great-grandchildren, the city that he'd helped to sponsor with the industry that he ran, the industry that he was responsible for encroached more and more on the countryside and grew as the city grew. And the house began to drop in value. And as it dropped in value, the grandchildren decided they had to sublet part of the house. And so they put in a second staircase. They did a conversion in the early 60s to be able to sublet the back of the house. As time went on, the house continued to decrease in value. The family moved out, squatters moved in, and the house became very decayed. Fires were set in the living rooms and in the hallways. And then eventually security moved in and kicked those people out, and then put a fence around the property. And then the Space Monkeys moved in and started making soap. So all of that history was designed for a couple of very specific reasons. First of all, because when you're designing a film, you're running a complex crew of people, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, 200 people who are building all of the components, and they need a lot of information in order to do their work. So the carpenters need to know what they're aging. They need to know, of course, about the architecture. The designers are designing that Victorian architecture and the functionality and the layout of the building. And then the paint crew needs to know exactly where to age and what to age. They need to know about the history of the house to be able to put in the kind of fine detail. So we have wallpaper from 5 or 6 different periods layered one on top of each other. We have fires set in the hallway that they know that they can age. They know that the windows are blocked up. They know for how long they've been blocked up. They know the conversion in the 60s was a later addition, so it's less aged. The deep, beautiful scenic work by the artist Tom Brown and his team builds up in layers and layers based very specifically on the history that we evolved for this house. The whole arc of time is embedded in the narrative that's carried by the architecture itself. So that's one reason for putting in this backstory. The other reason is, and I'm sorry you're just about to see the film, but if anyone hasn't seen the film, close your ears because here's the spoiler. Brad Pitt and Ed Norton are the same character. And so as the film goes on, a couple of things have to happen. The audience has to not know that they're the same character. They're talking to each other all the way through the film. But every time Marla Singer comes into the room, she has to only speak to one of them. In fact, she's only ever got to see the Ed Norton character. And so the Victorian house allowed us to have a servant's entrance in every room. The conversion in the 60s gave us another staircase and another access to the house. And these layers of narrative allowed us to play out this French farce where, without the audience realizing it, every time Marla walks into the room, either Brad or Ed disappear. Brad Pitt basically, you know, leaves the space. And then the moment she walks out, you'll see that Brad comes back and carries on the conversation. And it's always about, you know, never mention my name. This elaborate architecture of the narrative has to be supported by an elaborate architecture of the house itself, and the audience can never know it's happened. The house was built in several parts. The exterior that I mentioned in San Pedro in Long Beach was a facade, an entrance hallway, so you could enter, come up the stairs, open the door, move into the hallway, and the kitchen, because the kitchen needed to open out into the back garden where they were growing the herbs for the soap. And so we needed entrances and exits. But when you turn around and look back into the house from the kitchen, that was a replica set built on stage that gave you a view of all of the other rooms in the set that are all built on a stage. On one stage, the ground floor. On another stage, the upstairs. Built up on a platform so you could have stairway down, the two staircases going down. And then on another stage, the basement that needed to be flooded that we could build in a waterproof container. So again, an elaborate piece of machinery that hopefully is taken as a completely natural part of the narrative, an existing house that actually exists in a completely fictional city with a completely artificial device driving it in order for this very complicated story to take place. And all those paint textures and the flooding of the basement and the decay and the layers of wallpaper and the boarded up windows and the phones that don't work and the power that goes out, all of that really came directly out of my experience in the squad in Clissold Road in Stoke Newington, all of those, you know, for those years while I was at Central and printing t-shirts for Vivian Westwood. I want to thank all of you for inviting me to Design Manchester, and particularly my old friend, Malcolm Garrett, who, again, I've let down by not being there, but I've promised faithfully to be there next year, and I hope to see you all then. Thank you.
Trust me, everything's gonna be fine. Very strange time in my life.